process of interval graphs for limited nesting and counting of ranks. So, Pavel, Lyota, and Jim. So, the talk will be given by Pavel. So, please.
So thank you for this opportunity to give a talk here. I want to talk about interval graphs in a slightly non-traditional fashion. So first of all, my talk will be about graphs. What I mean by graphs here is the talk will be done by graphs. So this is the outline of the talk, what I will try to cover. Maybe let me use 1 or 2 minutes to introduce something on the site. This is something a project I've been involved for a couple of years. The goal of the project is to understand human mind in a different way that's traditionally done by self-observation. So you try to build models of your mind by understanding, by observations, by putting things together. And we use computer software to do so. So you can think of this diagram as a model of my mind, how I think of our paper, what are key points, how are linked together. I will try to guide you, give you a tour through my mind. At the end of the talk, you can see whether you got sort of my understanding of the topic or not. And also, I would like to say that if you're interested in the tool or in the method, you can just go to my website or you can write me an email and we can discuss or maybe after this talk. That, for instance, this tool, if you would be interested in it, it's run as an HTML website and it's freely available on our website. It's quite easy to do so. Okay, so let's go back to the talk. So my topic are something called interval graphs, and this is something involving the idea that when I have a graph, I don't think of a graph as a relation, but I think of a graph as a picture. Like, I think for a lot of you here, graph is something like this picture here on the left. So the idea is we want to take a graph and we want to draw it in some way, ideally in the way that will reveal us some additional properties. So basically from the drawing, we can see some structural properties of the graph. In particular, here we deal with so-called intersection representations. The idea is a little bit crazy at first, but it works very nicely. We assign a set to every vertex, and two vertices are adjacent if and only if this set intersects. So in the case of interval graphs, all these sets are closed intervals of the real line. So here we can see, for instance, red and orange are intersecting as intervals, so they are adjacent, but red and green are not intersecting, so they are not adjacent. So then a natural question, for instance, is which graphs can be done in this way, or you can also choose other ways how you can draw things and study that. So actually what you get are very nice classes which you can study from theoretical motivations and also applied motivations. Let me just give you a short history of interval graphs. They were introduced in 57, so they're almost 60 years old now. And actually the first application in the study of DNA and biology was very shortly after that by Benzer. Nowadays they can be used to model things like scheduling or biology, the study of DNA, because there is this linear topology loop from left to right. So you sort of have a real line to model it. Pipeline is also a real line. One thing is that they have very nice theoretical properties. For instance, they are perfect. You have multiple ways how you can characterize them. They are related to other graph classes, related to graph parameters. For instance, if you know path width, then the interval graphs are related to path width. And also, the essential, first of all, recognition, deciding whether a graph is an interval graph or not, and also solving most of the problems you can think of, everything can be done in linear time. And they include, for instance, clique, covering, independence, a dominating set, graph isomorphism, which is not provably hard, but solvably hard. We don't know how to solve it over many years. So we can do it in linear time on interval graphs. Okay, so these are interval graphs. I want to talk actually about some subclasses. And the most classical ones are these two subclasses below. So we have proper interval graphs and unit interval graphs. They're introduced in the 70s. So for proper interval graphs, what you do is that you take only interval graphs which can be represented in the way that no interval is properly included inside another interval. So when you have a pair of intersecting intervals, they intersect like this, never like this. And for unit interval graphs, this is much easier. You have all intervals of the same length equal one. And the basic relations between these two graph classes is that it's actually one graph class. It was proved by Roberts that every proper interval graph is also a unit interval graph and vice versa. My direction is quite easy because unit implies proper. The other is a little bit tricky. And also, I think in the original proof, it is done in the way that it is proved that K13 is not a proper interval graph. And then you sort of build it in this way. But you can also do it geometrically. So this is one of the classical results. And if I go a little bit back, because what I want to do in this talk, I want to give you more than details of our results, I want to give you the motivations and the directions, how we got where we are. And so what we were doing, we were working on a certain generalization of the recognition problem. As I said, recognition, I give you a graph and I ask you, does it belong to a class or not? In the case of a geometrically represented graph, we mostly ask, can be represented in that way, meaning we can certify it by giving a representation. So this is recognition. So we studied the generalization of it, which we call partial representation extension. It's a quite nice problem, a natural one. Surprisingly, it was not considered until 2010. So the idea is I give you a graph, and a part of the graph is already drawn for you. And you ask, can I add the remaining vertices? So this representation R prime, this partial representation, is a representation of an induced subgraph. So say this is an interval graph, but if I draw these three guys in a wrong order, I cannot finish it. I cannot add the purple guy here because it would have to intersect blue. Not possible. So here, for instance, you have an example of a non-extendable partial representation. So that was the algorithmic question and also the structural question. Like for which graph classes, for which types of representations, we can solve also this generalization. Generalization, if the partial representation is empty, we will get recognition. So originally, we solved the problem for interval graphs, actually in a quite nice, robust way. And there are also a lot of improvements down the way. These are the current results done by many different groups, different people, papers in many different conferences in the past. So we have some classes for which we can solve it efficiently. And then there are also some classes for which it's provably hard. So for instance, for chordal graphs, generalized interval graphs, is already NP complete. And there is sort of a motivation, other than the problem is quite natural and simple. The motivation is that it allows you to sort representations into two types. Representations which are very robust and you have good understanding of them. Interval graphs are perfect in this sense, or planar graphs are quite good. And on the other hand, representations which are very wild and complicated, and the algorithm works just by posing some assumptions and the partial representation might break it. So we have these provably hard things, when they involve geometry. And then we have also some open cases. These are classes, of course, which can be recognized in polynomial time, but the algorithms are very involved, and there is really no idea how to generalize it. It's that many steps do not generalize to partial representation extension. So it's an interesting question, because it also could lead to much better understanding of these graph classes, if it's possible. Could also be epicomplete. Would also imply something. So this was the problem we were studying. Let me show you one interesting case for us. These are proper and unit interval graphs. So, for proper interval graphs, one of the fundamental properties is the uniqueness of representation. Sort of. So, you can just take this unique representation and test whether it matches to the pretty long guys or not. But for unit interval graphs, this problem was much more involved because you have to deal with geometry. You have to deal with precise positions of intervals and you have to check whether these positions are compatible. It could happen that the ordering is good, but pretty long guys are too far or too close to each other. So what you can do is that on top of that, you run some linear programming and you can solve it. But the algorithm is much more involved. It was much harder to deal with unit interval graphs, even though they are the same. So in some sense, they are the same. In some other sense, they are really not. In the sense that these representations behave very differently. Classes are the same, but their representations are different. And when you study a problem which deals with representations, then it's not so easy. So, and another motivation was that we sort of generalized the problem to a more general called bounded representations. Then it was actually provably harder because one problem for proper interval graphs, the problem was solvable in polynomial time, but for unit interval graphs, the problem is incomplete. Basically, the geometry introduced to the class makes everything very complicated. And also sort of the essential motivation for us, and it's this generalization of unit interval graphs. The generalization is from the 80s. The idea is that instead of one length, I will allow at most k lengths. So, and the representation using at most k different lengths of intervals. So this is example of a two-length interval graph. And so if you go a little bit in the timeline, it goes 30 years back. Actually, it's interesting, when we were studying these problems, I came up with this question completely independently. I didn't know about this line of research. So I asked at some conference, what's complexity of that? No one had any idea. Then I searched a little bit in, and we found out that there is some work done on that. And some work, but not that much. It started in the 80s. There was a bunch of papers quickly following. Actually, the problem was suggested by Graham, but I couldn't find any reference, so it had to be in some personal communication, but it's the credit is given to him. And then there's also a bunch of recent papers. But and the problem here is that these classes are completely valid. Like the idea would be that, okay, I have this general class and this restricted class. And this restricted class has many nice properties which the general class doesn't have. For instance, recognition for proper and unit interval graphs is incredibly simple. For interval graphs, linear time algorithm took many years. And it's not so easy that I could explain to you in full details. So, was the idea that, okay, we will make this hierarchy of more general graphs and hopefully they will be close to unit interval graphs and some of these properties will be shared and we will be very happy. We can run some parameterized algorithm, etc. And unfortunately, it didn't work out that way. The reason is because the geometry makes it insanely complicated. Let me give you a simple example. What I would like to have is that my class is closed under disjoint union. If I take, say, two graphs representable by two different lengths, I put them next to each other, I want it to be representable by two different lengths. Not really. Here's an example of two graphs. On the left, you construct it in the way that short interval is much shorter than the red guy. On the right, you construct it that it's not so much shorter. And you put it together, you require three different lengths. All the techniques for interval graphs work in the way that you decompose the graph into pieces. You deal with the pieces, then you put them together, and you do sort of like dynamic type of algorithm on this hierarchical structure. It's not possible here. You would have to do something more complicated, like to compute which possible combinations of lengths are possible. It's also possible because these relations are very valid. There are examples of that. So you can really take all of these results are pretty much some kind of curiosities. Like, okay, if we look at two-length internal graphs, they have these strange properties, these strange examples, strange properties, non-expected behavior. Can't really build any theory about it. And then this more recent result, except for this purple one, which is an application, are more or less, okay, let's restrict the graph class in the way that it's almost proper internal graphs. That has nothing to do with the original problem anymore. So I would say, even though these graph classes were studied for 30 years, sadly not much is known. Now, for instance, forbidden subgraphs, you can forget about that. It's really complicated. For instance, if you remove a vertex, you can decrease the number of lengths not by one, but by two, and etc. And really, it doesn't seem very friendly. Concerning computational results, almost nothing is known. This is paper of Skrien for lengths 0 and 1, but that's almost proper. And then there are these new papers which deal with highly restricted internal graphs. It doesn't really give you any insight to the general problem. So we have a graph class which was studied for 30 years and pretty much nothing was done for it. It seems insanely complicated. If you don't know how to do recognition, you can't use it for anything. It's really useless. It's just a very hard problem. It's a puzzle. And so that was like we sort of wanted to take a look at the graph class. We found out it's really nothing we can do there. The current theory for internal graphs is completely useless. But let me show you one other motivation when you looked at it. This is paper from like 3 years ago. There's the idea of testing first order logic formulas for a graph. So in general, you can do it in XP and it's W too hard, but you can ask for restricted graph classes. Can I decide, say, my formula over planar graphs? And you can do it in FPT. And for many sparse classes, it was known that it can be done in FPT. But in 2013, there was this result that it can be done also for a dense class. Not for interval graphs, though it's hard, but for k-like interval graphs. But the parameter is not only with respect to k, but also with respect to these particular sizes, these lengths of intervals. So for different lengths, you get different complexity. But it was the first FPT type of result in this direction. So one could be thinking, okay, this could be some motivation to study these graph classes. Fortunately, a few years later, a different technique was used to solve also this other graph class, this more general graph class I will talk about in this talk. And as a side mark, both of these FPT algorithms need to have a representation. So the first result is useless if you can't solve recognition. The second result was useless if you can't solve recognition, but recognition is not difficult to do, and we did it in our paper. So if you combine this result from Fox with our paper, then you get an FPT algorithm with respect to K and Y. So, and that's really the difference, that we can go in a different direction, we can generalize proper interval graphs. So for proper interval graphs, we are going to forbid a tower of big height. So I'm going to forbid k plus one tower of nested intervals. So there are no intervals nested in each other like this. So for k equal one, you will get proper. And for a graph, you can also consider this parameter. So actually not much was known about it. The only reference we found is in this book by Fishburne. There is a parameter called depth, and this parameter is studied a little bit, like one or two pages, and it's linked to k-length interval graphs. So that's it. And there is nothing else. There are some other much weaker generalizations, but they are not linked to this. So basically what we did is we wanted to do something in this direction of k-length interval graphs, but something we actually can study and we can get some results for it. And so how are they related? It's not difficult to see that if you first you have these two simple inclusions, but then if you have only k1s, you cannot have a tower of size k plus one. So you get this k-nested interval graphs are strictly generalizing k-like interval graphs. Actually, for strictly, there is this old result of Fishburne, a little bit surprising, that if you consider k-nested for any k larger than 1, then it's not contained in L length for any parameter L. It's not realizable by a finite number of lengths, no matter what it is k. So, for instance, two nested interval graphs cannot be done in a finite number of lengths. So these graph classes are much larger. If you study them from the point of optimization, solving some graph problem, you don't really have to deal with geometry, because you can just take these bigger graph classes, solve it there, and then you're happy. So this is the idea. So let me show you some computer science motivations. Okay, maybe. Nah, I'll just go over the results because I don't have that much of time. But so what we got? We have two problems and two graph classes. So what we can do is we can do recognition in linear time. The algorithm is relatively simple. It's 2 or 3 pages. Then we can generalize it also to this partial representation extension problem. The algorithm gets much more involved, but it's possible to use the technique. It just takes a lot of work to do it. And I think when we work a little bit more, we can get maybe to quadratic or linear time as well. It's just too lazy to compute it. And for k lengths, we have this long-standing open problem. No one has any idea how to do it. That's not really useful, in my opinion. And then we have this pool level hardness, if we consider partial representation extension. So the reduction is from free partition. And just like one big picture, how this is done, there is something called PQ3s. PQ3s describe all interval representations, and then you just play dynamic algorithm with PQ3s. So the approach is natural, the details are a little bit more complicated, but it can be worked out. So basically, after a few weeks of work, we have fundamental understanding, like basic understanding of this graph class. After 30 years of work, no one has any idea how to deal with this. So this is the point of my talk. So thanks a lot.